Hi, I'm Jeff Dallas.
And I'm Jacob Farin. We're co-owners of Sarracenia Northwest, and we specialize in carnivorous plants. This is the third and final volume of the Grow Carnivorous Plants DVD series. In this volume, we're going to show you how to grow tropical pitcher plants, specifically Nepenthes.
Now, when I first began growing carnivorous plants, and I saw for the very first time a picture of a Nepenthes in a book, I couldn't believe what a bizarre, exotic plant this was. And every place that I read, whether it be in different books or magazines and that, they were always described as plants that had to be in really special conditions, real high humidity, they had to be warm, and you had to just do all this fussing to take care of these plants. And I believed that for a long time, and I actually purchased one. I found one in a garden center several years ago, and still this was the information that I had at that time about their care. But I didn't have a greenhouse at that time. I didn't have special terrariums and enclosures or special lights or anything else that I'd heard that you're supposed to have for these kinds of plants. So I just went ahead and I took it and I hung it in an east-facing window that I had in my kitchen and just watered it and kind of left it alone. I figured, you know, if it dies, it dies. It didn't die. Not only did it not die, it thrived. It grew new pitchers, it got bigger, it became a very long vine, very big conversation piece in our kitchen inside there, and I did nothing but have a sunny window for it and water this plant.
Beside us, we have a prayer plant, a Sarracenia, a Phalaenopsis orchid, a ginger plant. These are common house plants that you might find at your local garden center. They're very easy to grow as long as you have a very bright windowsill and you remember to water them. So if you can grow these plants, you can grow Nepenthes.
Before we get into the nuts and bolts of growing tropical pitcher plants, we probably better take a moment or two here to go ahead and show you what exactly a tropical pitcher plant is, and we'll start with the biggest family of those, which is the Nepenthes. Now what I have in front of me right here is a Nepenthes sanguinea, and Nepenthes as a family are a group of woody vining plants, and they're found all over Southeast Asia in a lot of different types of terrains and habitats, and being a tropical plant, they definitely are one that grows in conditions that are usually warm pretty much all year. There's where these plants grow, there's almost never any freezing that occurs with them. But I want to take you on just a quick tour here of what the plants are like and some of their structures on here. Now, as I mentioned, being a woody vine, you can see like this one right now is beginning to send up a long tendril, and it's not at all uncommon for these plants to go ahead and to begin climbing up the sides of trees or going up the edges of brush in that. Now, what you're looking here, you can see the main stem part. Here's just the main leaf of the plant right here, and this part of the plant looks very ordinary, like any other type of plant that you might imagine. Now, coming off the end of the leaf, what we have here is what's referred to as the tendril, and this is where things begin getting a bit different on these types of plants. The tendril will grow, like you see this is doing right here, and it'll often loop up the way that you see right now, and the end of that is going to begin to develop and swell into a new structure. This little loop that you see right here also, this will sometimes loop around other vegetation to offer foothold to for the plant to be able to climb up trees and other vegetation. As this begins to grow and swell, it'll eventually get hollow on the inside, get much larger, and when it finally develops to its full point, you have what we have right here, and this is a full-size pitcher. Now, the pitcher has some different parts on it here also. Top up here, we usually call the lid or sometimes the hood. This lip that goes all the way around the exterior on the opening is referred to as a peristome, and it's just a hard surface that makes it difficult for insects to get out once they begin slipping inside here. Now these front parts you see down here, these little bristles, are just referred to as an ala or a wing that's on here. A lot of botanists debate about what that's actually for on them. Some of the Nepenthes have it, some of them don't. And on a few Nepenthes species, they also have a little structure underneath the lid here referred to as a keel that you can see on this plant really clearly. And the keel sometimes has nectar on it that acts as an attractant for insects. Now we want to show you a little bit more of what the inside of the pitcher actually looks like and a little bit about how the pitcher actually captures some insects. You can see on the inside, there's kind of a waxy appearance just underneath the peristome or that little lip inside there. That is really waxy. It's very difficult for insects to have any foothold whatsoever if they get to that area inside the pitcher. Now I'm going to go ahead and cut it open here so you can see what the inside looks like, because there's some really exciting things going on in here. Not exciting if you're a bug, however. I made an incision down the side of the wall so you can see the contents, and you can see more of that waxy surface inside there. You can also see all of that fluid that's in there, and this is mostly water. The plant does secrete that fluid in there itself, although it does get some rain in there. We've clipped off the lid so you can see it a little bit better, but the lid also helps to keep some of the excessive rainwater out. Now you can also see a couple of little gnats or some insects that are floating on the top, and the water is slightly discolored. Now there's a reason for that. There's more insects probably down in the bottom of this that the plant has captured. Let's go ahead and show you what's deeper down inside the pitcher. And there you can see there's a moth down in there, some other floating insects. Now down in this zone, kind of past where you can see there was a texture change, there's hundreds and hundreds of little tiny dots down where the water is. Those little dots are digestive glands, and those secrete enzymes that the plant puts into the water to break the insects down, and this is how the plant is getting its fertilizer. Now, as I was mentioning earlier, these plants definitely come from a variety of different habitats in Southeast Asia. Some Nepenthes you're going to find climbing up either the sides of trees or going across brush into open forest canopy, and they have this little loop that they produce around the in the tendril they can use to hook on to plants as they go up. Some are found low in the forest floor and are just growing really close to the ground in leaf litter at the base of trees. There's some that are found in almost subalpine areas, again in the tropics though, not you wouldn't see snow or anything there, but at very high elevations in the mountainous areas of Southeast Asia. So this is definitely a family of plants that's not one size fits all. There's a lot of different varieties and variances in care requirements for them also based on where they come from.
When you first learn about Nepenthes, you'll encounter terms like lowland, intermediate, and highland. Those terms actually refer to where the plants are found along the mountainside. Obviously, lowland occurs low down in the mountain, and highland occurs higher up in the mountains near the mountaintops. Intermediate is a term that kind of straddles the border between lowland and highland. The borderline between lowland and highland is a bit arbitrary, but most botanists put that border at the 3,000 foot level or 1,000 meters. Now, lowland species like it hot and humid almost constantly, day and night. As you travel up the mountainside, the days are still warm, but the nights get chilly. So those terms, lowland, highland, and intermediate, kind of gives you a guideline on how to grow these plants. Well, let's start off with the intermediate and highland species, because these are the species that you'll most likely encounter in cultivation. The most common of the species is Nepenthes sanguinea. It's native to Malaysia, and sanguinea in Latin means blood red. And this specimen certainly takes after its name. Nice dark red pitchers. Another variety of Nepenthes sanguinea is the orange pitcher. And again, this plant, the orange pitcher variety, is one that you'll find most often in cultivation. Related to Nepenthes sanguinea is Nepenthes ramispina, noted for its dark pitchers and lime green interior. And again, this plant is also native to Malaysia. Another plant you'll find in Malaysia is Nepenthes albomarginata. And it gets its name for its white band, albomarginata, along the rim of the pitcher. This is a dark pitcher variety, and we also have a red pitcher variety of the same species. A a very beautiful plant. Now we move into the Indonesian islands like Sumatra, Borneo, Sulawesi. This plant is Nepenthes macfarlane. And this one here, its name is Nepenthes spectabilis. And it has a very beautiful striped peristome. And what's also interesting about this species is that the pitcher is slightly velvety. Also native to the Indonesian islands is Nepenthes gymnophora. It's a smaller species, produces smaller pitchers. And what's unique about this one is that the pitchers, rather than hanging down, they form along the soil line. So they form a cluster of pitchers. Right here is Nepenthes maxima. And this is really unusual because when you grow it in very bright light, the leaves turn red and it looks like a poinsettia. Related to Nepenthes maxima is Nepenthes aime. They're very closely related. They occur on the same island in Indonesia, Sulawesi. Right down here, this small guy is Nepenthes taligensis. A very dainty little pitcher there. We also have Nepenthes stenophylla. And what's unusual about this one is that the leaves are very hairy. We also have Nepenthes bongzo, Nepenthes rinwartiana. But what's unusual about that one is that when the pitcher matures, you'll see eye spots inside the pitcher. One of my favorites is Nepenthes cingulana. And now moving out of the Indonesian islands, going into the Philippines, we have Nepenthes sibuyanensis. It forms short, tubby pitchers right at the soil line. Now, this is a small specimen. This species will get very large. The size of like footballs. We also have Nepenthes copelandii. This is a recent introduction to cultivation. It forms straight pitchers mottled with brown, a very beautiful specimen. And we have Nepenthes alata. This is a speckled variety. Another variety of the Nepenthes alata is this one, from the Luzon district of the Philippines. And you will find this species very commonly in cultivation. And we also have Nepenthes ventricosa. Ventricosa in Latin means pot belly. And so you can see how this plant got its name for its tubby-like base at the pitcher. Related to ventricosa is Nepenthes burkei. Now, one of the most spectacular species in cultivation is Nepenthes truncata. Now, Nepenthes truncata has a wide distribution in the Philippines. It occurs in lowland and highland regions. This is a lowland variety. And this little guy will turn into something like this. It has leathery pitchers and a really wide, colorful peristome. Now again, this is the lowland variety. The lowland species, or variety I should say, tends to grow larger and quicker. In comparison, the highland variety grows a bit slower, produces smaller pitchers, but red pitchers. So it's equally as beautiful and striking. Now, to give you some idea of how fast these plants grow, this is the lowland variety, and this is the highland variety, and they're the same age. So you can see that the lowland variety grows quicker and will produce larger pitchers for the same age. Now that you've seen the intermediate and highland Nepenthes, here are some of the ultra highland Nepenthes. They occur further up in the mountains. one of the characteristics about the ultra highland Nepenthes is that they're very slow growing. And the reason for that is because the nights are very chilly. So they grow quite slowly and take a lot of patience if you're gonna try growing one of these plants. This one is Nepenthes izumier. They do produce really large pitchers and very colorful ones. They range from this color, kind of an orange, to a much darker chocolatey pitcher. Now, native to the island of Borneo in Indonesia is Nepenthes epiphyata. It's a very slow-growing plant, but what's notable about this one are the bristles located underneath the hood. Also on the island of Borneo is Nepenthes raja. And raja in Sanskrit means king. This particular plant has the capabilities of producing gallon-sized pitchers. I mean, they're huge. This one is a king in training. It likes very cool and bright conditions. And speaking of slow growing, here's the slowest of them all, Nepenthes villosa. It has tubby pitchers that lay on the ground, and the peristome is very toothy. This particular specimen is 10 years old. Now we also have Nepenthes inermis. An inermis in Latin means thornless. The main characteristic of this Nepenthes is its wine glass shaped pitchers and Nepenthes dubia, a very close relative to Nepenthes inermis. And like inermis, it has a bright red stem. You could almost say that dubia is a red version of Nepenthes inermis. Finally, we get to the crowning jewel of any Nepenthes collection, and that is Nepenthes hamada. This gorgeous species has a very toothy peristome, hairy lid, and mottled pitchers. Almost every collector wants a specimen like this. They grow very slowly. This little guy is the same species, and it's about 2 years old. And this one here is about 7 years old. Now, one of the things you might find missing in our collection of Nepenthes are the lowlanders. And the reason for that is because the lowland Nepenthes want really warm nights. At our nursery in Oregon, our nights are too cold for them. However, we do have one lowland Nepenthes, and that's Nepenthes mirabilis. It has a very wide distribution. You'll find it in northern Australia, Indonesia, Malaysia, Papua New Guinea, Vietnam, Singapore, and all the way into southern China. Now, there are other lowland Nepenthes that are worth noting, and that's like the Nepenthes ampullaria, which is native to Malaysia and Sumatra. It produces a cluster of pitchers near the base of the plant. Another good lowland Nepenthes is Nepenthes rafflesiana. And this one produces very beautiful, striking, and large pitchers. But we cannot forget about the most famous of the lowland species, and that is Nepenthes bicalcarata. That one is native to Borneo. It is a very lowland species. It occurs in the swampy areas of the rainforest on Borneo. But what's really notable about that plant are the keels under the hood that look like fangs. And this plant can get big with a leaf span of 3 feet and pitchers the size of a football.
Now earlier, Jacob was taking you on a tour of Southeast Asia and showing you many of the different Nepenthes species that exist in different parts of the world. Now Nepenthes, just like most plants, are flowering plants also, but there's something that makes them a little bit different, and that is that they have separate male and female flowers on separate plants, which is referred to as being dioecious with that. So you have to have a male and a female plant of the same species to go ahead and to get seeds. However, Nepenthes are also a group of plants that very freely hybridize. You can crossbreed different species of plants. And here's a good example of that. Earlier, Jacob showed you a Nepenthes maxima, just like this one, very beautiful, very red plant. And then, of course, our really giant over here, Nepenthes truncata. Now, if these two plants were in bloom at the same time and one was male and one was female, you could transfer pollen from one to the other, and when you grew those seeds, what you would get is this. And here's a hybrid between the two species. And if you look at it, you can easily see that there's characteristics of both plants in this. Our little hybrid here has a bunch of the stripes that the Maxima had that you saw there. It's got these big, thick leaves and truncated in leaves, just like the Nepenthes truncata. Now, one thing that's also really nice about hybrids is they tend to exhibit something called hybrid vigor. They tend to be a little more vigorous than either of their parent plants because they tend to get the best of both worlds. Although it's not always true, it's very often true. And so often, Nepenthes hybrids are some of your best choices for first-time plants you maybe want to grow in your home because they are a lot more tolerant of a range of conditions. Now, here's some really good examples of those. Over here, we have a plant that's referred to as Derouza's alata. It's a cross between Nepenthes alata and Nepenthes ventricosa. Very stout little grower, very commonly sold in garden centers and places. Over here beside me on the other, we have Nepenthes cross Miranda, and it's a cross between Nepenthes northiana, which is a very large plant and a lowlander, and Nepenthes maxima, which you just saw there also. And it's also a very stout grower, very tolerant of a wide range of conditions, and gets very large. And both of these are very likely to be much easier plants for the first time grower than some of the species would be.
As mentioned earlier, Nepenthes secrete nectar along the rim and hood of the pitcher to lure insects. When an insect falls into the pitchers, it drowns in the digestive fluids below. In cultivation, Nepenthes will commonly capture ants and yellow jackets. Occasionally, they will also capture roaches, centipedes, and house geckos. When it comes to insects, a lot of growers often ask, do I have to feed my plants insects? The answer is no. Carnivorous plants are plants. They are not animals or pets. They are plants. Just as regular plants get their fertilizer through their roots, carnivorous plants get their fertilizer through their leaves. Insects are simply little packets of fertilizer. If you want to be successful, care for carnivorous plants as plants.
Now, as Jeff mentioned earlier, bugs are simply a source of fertilizer for the plants, not a source of energy. Plants get their energy from sunlight. And so these plants, Nepenthes, need sunlight to produce pitchers, enzymes, and fluids to capture and digest insects. Without proper sunlight, Nepenthes won't be able to produce beautiful pitchers. So how much sunlight does a Nepenthes need? Well, that depends on the species and the hybrid and the habitat that they're from. This hybrid here is Nepenthes miraliana crossed with alata. And as you can see, it can take a tremendous amount of sunlight. The more sun it gets, the redder the leaves get. And this is how you can tell that this plant is getting lots of sun. Now, other plants don't like that much sun, but in general, Nepenthes require a tremendous amount of sunlight. You won't go wrong if you provide very bright filter light throughout the day. If possible, provide some direct sunlight, a few hours, 2 to 4 hours of direct sunlight and bright indirect sunlight throughout the day is optimal for these plants.
All right, I want to spend a moment here talking about watering Nepenthes a bit, because one thing that's very different about these plants, if you saw one of our previous videos on growing like North American carnivorous plants, those plants are actually bog plants. Most of the Nepenthes are not, and so they're not plants that like to sit in water all the time, which in many ways, though, makes these a lot easier to take care of because they're far more like regular houseplants than many of the other carnivorous plants are. And so if you have a typical, like we have a couple right here, and if you're going to go water one of these, you're really just going to water it enough so that you got the soil moistened. I'm going to let some of this run off, so you might need to have something underneath it that'll catch some of the water. And I've got like a little tray on the bottom of this one. It's okay for a little bit of water to be down in there, but you just go ahead and just water till the soil's moist. They do like to stay a little on the moister side, but they will tolerate some drying in their soil. Like over here on this one too, there's a little bit larger tray. It's okay if you water one of those. And if some water accumulates down there in the tray, that's just fine. I would let it use that water up completely though before you go ahead and add more. Your Nepenthes will grow best if you keep them kind of consistently moist. They don't have to be soaking wet like I mentioned before, but the soil should feel a little damp to the touch when you touch it. If it's starting to feel dry, it's definitely time to water. You'll definitely be watering more in the summer than you will in the winter, obviously, it's because of the heat. Now, one other issue that comes up a lot, especially with carnivorous plants of any kind, is the whole issue of hard water. Nepenthes, fortunately, are not nearly as sensitive to hard water as many other types of carnivorous plants. So if you happen to have a lot of minerals in your water, especially calcium, magnesium, those kinds of things that create the hard water stains on faucets in your house, you can use that water, but you're going to have to change your soil a little more often and plan on at least every other year repotting your plants if that does begin to build up. Something else that can help a whole bunch too if your water is really hard is once in a while, just go buy yourself a jug of steam distilled water, which has absolutely no minerals in it whatsoever, and then just go ahead and on your plant, just use a whole gallon, just douse that thing and wash it through to help rinse out some of the excess minerals that may be accumulated in there. All right, I want to spend a few moments here talking about soil, because this is often an area of great confusion when it comes to repotting and taking care of Nepenthes and what it is they're supposed to grow in. It helps a little bit, though, to think of this kind of in conceptual terms, sort of like some big picture ideas, as opposed to use this or use that with specific types of ingredients. And the reason for this is because in nature, Nepenthes are often found in a whole wide variety of different types of soils. You'll find some growing in mucky clay. There's some that are growing in more ordinary type forest soils. Some are going to be growing in moss, especially at higher elevations. Some are almost epiphytic, where they're just kind of like hanging on to like moss on the sides of the trees as they grow. So the important things for a potting medium for Nepenthes is that it holds some moisture, because there's a lot of rainfall in the area where these come from, and yet it needs to be loose and open, so water needs to drain through it freely, which is very different than many of the other varieties of carnivorous plants and what their soil tends to be like. Now what I have here in my tray is a variety of different materials that are often used in Nepenthes potting mediums, and there's some big differences between the different materials and what they do. But again, what we're after here when we put some stuff together is we want something that will hold some moisture yet have good draining properties where there's a lot of air spaces around those roots inside the pot. Over here on this side, what I have, this sort of loose flaky stuff, is long fiber sphagnum moss. And sphagnum moss is well known for the amount of water that it can hold. Matter of fact, I believe it can hold somewhere in the neighborhood of probably 50 times its own weight in water. So it's definitely good for that purpose. Right next to it is what sphagnum moss turns into after many centuries in bogs, and that's peat moss. And peat moss is also a very good water holder. It's a little bit on the acid side and adds some things to the media that can be really helpful to them. This stuff here in the middle is volcanic pumice, and pumice has a lot of little air spaces in it. It also usually, when it comes in bags, has a lot of different particle sizes, which again really helps to create those air spaces. This substance that's kind of brownish gray is vermiculite. Vermiculite is expanded mica. Now vermiculite has some nice properties to it in that it does tend to drain quickly, yet it also holds quite a bit of water at the same time. What I have here is a very fine grade of vermiculite. If you can find the coarser grades, those are the better ones to use. Here we have just some ordinary orchid bark. I believe this is fir bark. And again, this can add some different chunky sizes to the media so water can go through it. And here we have perlite. And perlite's very similar to the pumice, except this is like a synthetic lava rock. Perlite is often a lot easier to find than pumice is. A lot of garden centers carry perlite. And the stuff that you see back here across the back is coconut chips. And so this is the outer husk of a coconut. It's just cut up into little chips. And this holds a fair amount of moisture, but you can see from the sizes, can definitely let lots of water pass through that. Which mix you decide to use may depend a lot on just what you have available in your particular area of the country. I mean, one good example of that is the volcanic pumice. Here in the Pacific Northwest, any place on the West Coast, this stuff is pretty abundant because it comes from volcanoes not in our area. This may be very difficult to find on the East Coast, however, so you may use a different substance in that case. Now here's some examples of some specific soil mixes that are actually used in cultivation for Nepenthes. Now I'm going to start with one that we use right here at our nursery at Sarracenia Northwest, and that's this one right here. We go for a very simple mix of equal parts by volume, coconut chips, and long fiber sphagnum moss. And this is just mixed together and gotten very wet before we use it. The reason we use this particular mix is both these ingredients are easy for us to find, it holds plenty of water, and because we do lots of top watering and it drips through, this doesn't erode away out of the pots very quickly either, so it suits our needs here at the nursery very well. Another very common mix, this one was recommended by an author that I gained much of my information from back in the 1980s, is a mixture of one part peat moss, two parts perlite, and two parts orchid bark in here. And again, you end up with a really coarse media, yet it holds a certain amount of water. This works great. This is a really good media, and these ingredients are pretty easy to find. Now in this jar, we have a mixture that's used by a very well-known carnivorous plant grower in California. And this is an example of like having a little bit of everything. It's sort of your custom deluxe mix of different ingredients. And here we've got by equal parts vermiculite, bark, pumice, peat moss, perlite, and long fiber sphagnum moss all together. And this is gonna create really excellent drainage and mixtures of textures and air spaces in here. However, probably the disadvantage for this is you may not be able to find all these ingredients at your garden center depending on where you live, but there's nothing wrong with this mix. It works great. Now I mentioned earlier in the video too, talking about hard water and some of the issues with that doesn't affect Nepenthes very much. What hard water can do, however, is it can break down the organic soil ingredients, such as the sphagnum moss or the peat moss that can be in there. If you live in an area with really hard water, you might opt to use a mixture like this. And this is a pure mineral mix. This has, by equal parts in here, pumice, perlite, and vermiculite. Now, this mix drains a lot quicker. It also dries out a lot faster, so you have to be really diligent about your watering. Vermiculite does hold quite a bit of water, but it's going to dry out a lot faster than these mixes will. However, this is not going to cause you as many problems if you're in an area that has really hard water. Now, overall, as you can kind of see here, the Nepenthes are not that picky about what kind of soil they're in. The important stuff here is just having the right properties, which is having that porosity and the ability of the media to go ahead and hold moisture also. And so what you decide to use may depend a lot on just what you have available in your particular area.
Sunlight is one of the most important aspects about growing Nepenthes. It takes a lot of energy for Nepenthes to produce their gorgeous pictures. Remember that Nepenthes don't get energy from bugs. Bugs are only a source of fertilizer, such as nitrogen, phosphorus, and trace minerals. Instead, Nepenthes, and all plants for that matter, get their energy from sunlight. If light levels are too low, Nepenthes won't produce any pictures. Most plants will need bright, filtered light with a few hours of direct sun. Specific lighting requirements will vary from species to species. Nepenthes are tolerant of hard water as long as the soil drains freely. In many instances, tap water is perfectly okay. In general, if your tap water is safe to use on houseplants, it's safe to use on Nepenthes. If you're unsure about your water quality, use distilled water, which you can purchase at your local grocery store. If you choose to use tap water, make sure to flush the soil with distilled water at least once a month. Flushing the soil will reduce mineral buildup. For more information about water quality and water filters, see Volume 1. When it comes to soil, Nepenthes grow well in a variety of soil mixes. The actual soil ingredients you use will depend on what is available in your region. Whichever soil recipe you use, make sure the soil maintains moisture and drains freely. The soil should also be low in nutrients. Avoid using potting soil, compost, and fertilizer-enriched soil ingredients. Keep the soil moist at all times. Unlike other carnivorous plants, avoid setting the pot in water. Instead, top water the soil and use a saucer to capture the runoff. If your water is hard, use a granular mix that allows water to drain rapidly.
All right, in addition to light soil and water, I wanted to talk a little bit about humidity, because this is an issue that comes up a lot when it comes to growing tropical pitcher plants, especially considering where they come from in Southeast Asia, which is a very hot, humid area. And I remember when I first started growing carnivorous plants back into the 70s and 80s, I was still, everything that I read and I'd heard about said that these plants had to be in really super high humidity all the time. Now, back around the middle of the 1990s, I founded a garden center. They had for sale a really pretty Derusalata like this one, which is one of the plants we sell here at Sarracenia Northwest. And I bought one, but at the time, I didn't really have a really nice enclosure or a greenhouse to go ahead and put one in. And so I just went ahead and hung it in my kitchen window. And I thought, you know, if it dies, it dies. It wasn't that expensive. So I just watered it and kind of left it alone. It was in a northeast facing kitchen window. It was getting some sun in that. And I was fully expecting at that point all the pitchers to dry up and the plants start looking bad. But that's not what happened. Instead, it began growing more pitchers. Some of the older ones began dying away. And the pitchers were actually brighter and darker than the original ones that it had had before. And the humidity in our house at that place was no more than probably anywhere between 20% and 50% at the most. I'm sure at times it was a lot lower than that. And so this became just a very nice windowsill plant for me. So that was one of my first experiences realizing not all of these plants have to have really high humidity all the time, that normal household conditions can be just fine. A good friend of mine, not too many years ago, had this plant. And this is a Nepenthes sanguinea that you may have saw in one of the earlier segments. He was living over in Central Oregon. Now in Central Oregon here in our state is high desert. It is very low humidity. He had this just sitting in a kitchen window where it was sunny. He made sure it was watered. It pitchered beautifully. So the bottom line here is with humidity is not all these guys have to be in high humidity. As a matter of fact, a lot of them will do just fine in normal household conditions. There are exceptions to this. Some of the lowlanders that require, you know, the really warm, humid conditions, they definitely need higher humidity. Some of the ultra highlanders that Jacob talked about, they need it also. But many of the common ones we see available in cultivation are no more fussy than an ordinary houseplant as far as those humidity requirements go. So you can definitely have some fun with these guys, as many years ago, nobody thought you ever could. Now earlier we went ahead and took you through some of the basic growing concepts, things like light, water, and soil that Nepenthes require. Before we get into putting this all together though, I wanted to talk a little bit about what are some really good species to actually select for having as houseplants for your home. Now, I'm going to give you a list here of some ones. There's some very practical ones, and mostly they're a lot easier to find also out in nurseries and other places. One that would be at the top of my list would be Nepenthes sanguinea. This is a very common plant in the nursery trade, very beautiful, very tolerant of a wide range of conditions, and really can become an amazing houseplant for sure. You saw that great big Nepenthes truncata that we had out in the greenhouse. That is also an excellent houseplant. Grows a little slower, but can get to a monstrous size. Doesn't require a lot of special care whatsoever. It's just a very stout grower. Nepenthes alata, nice long vining plant. You can actually trellis it if you want to. Has some really pretty colors in some of the different varieties. Also, very straightforward plant. Nepenthes copelandii, very pretty. You saw the example we had out in the greenhouse of that. A little slower grower also, but again, not fussy, just a real pleasant plant to have. Nepenthes ramispina, beautiful black color on the outside of those pitchers. Definitely a slow grower, but as long as you keep it watered and give it what it wants, it'll be very happy in your home. Nepenthes ventricosa, great plant. If you need something that's in a little bit smaller space or you don't have quite as big a windows because it doesn't get quite as tall as some of the other varieties do, and really cute with those tubby pitchers that they make on there. Now, also hybrids of these plants can be excellent plants in your home, and sometimes the hybrids are almost better because they're even more tolerant of mistakes than that people might make. The Derusalata, the reddish one that we showed you earlier, fantastic plant, very easy to find. The great big Nepenthes miranda, if you want a really large plant, excellent candidate for that, can get just massive pitchers on it with a minimal amount of care. Now really try to avoid the mistake that a lot of first-time growers do, and that is they want to go for the most bizarre, the most exotic Nepenthes they can find, like the bicalcarata with the fangs or the hamada with the big teeth on it. Those plants require a little more exacting conditions than the species that I just mentioned to you, and those are better to wait until you've had a little more experience with Nepenthes, and then maybe try your hand at one of the more difficult ones like that. But if you stick with those common ones and have one of those as one of your first Nepenthes houseplants, you'll have a plant that will probably be with you for many, many years.
When growing Nepenthes for the first time, start with easy-to-grow plants. These include Nepenthes sanguinea, Nepenthes truncata, Nepenthes alata, Nepenthes coplandii, Nepenthes ventricosa, Nepenthes derusalata, and Nepenthes miranda. These plants adapt to a wide range of growing conditions, so they make very good houseplants regardless of where you live in the United States. If you happen to live where the nights are warm and relatively humid, you can grow some of the lowland to intermediate species, such as Nepenthes rafflesiana, Nepenthes albomarginatum, Nepenthes reinwortiana, and Nepenthes mirabilis. So if you happen to live in the eastern regions of the United States where summer nights are warm and humid, you can also add these plants to your list. When growing Nepenthes for the first time, avoid growing the temperamental species, such as the ultra highlands and the ultra lowlands. These include species such as Nepenthes amara, Nepenthes raja, and Nepenthes bicalcarata. While they're very spectacular plants, they prefer a very narrow growing range. The ultra highland species, such as Hamada and Raja, prefer consistently cool temperatures, while the ultra lowland species, such as Bicalcarata, prefer consistently warm temperatures. Consider growing these plants after you've gained successful experience with plants mentioned earlier.
Now, we've just talked about some of the species that would be good. Now, once you have your plant, you have to choose where you're going to have that plant in your house. Now, as you learned about in light, one of the considerations is you're going to have at least 3 to 4 hours of direct sun and then bright indirect light the rest of the day. So you have to choose your windows correctly as to where you put them. One really great place for a lot of houses is going to be a west window, because many houses get bright sun in the afternoon for several hours in a west window, and it'll give you a lot of options in the kind of plants that you can have in that place. South windows can often work very well in the house also. South windows are going to receive more light in the spring and in the fall, and a little bit less in the summer, although you'll have bright indirect light during the midday when the sun is directly overhead. What will not work is a north window, because north windows get maybe just a little tiny bit of direct sun during the summertime, if you're lucky, and then just indirect light for the rest of the day. That is not bright enough for Nepenthes. It's actually not bright enough for about 99% of carnivorous plants. And so you definitely want to go for those windows that have the bright sun. Now, whether you choose a west or a south window, you may just have to kind of figure out in your house which one actually gets more sun. If you have things that maybe obstruct from the outside, different kinds of trees, buildings, whatever that happens to be. So you have to kind of look at that for your particular situation. Also, be aware if you have windows that happen to have strong UV blocking glass. They make some special windows like that now for energy conservation, so it doesn't cause problems with carpets and that in your house. Those can sometimes block so much of the needed rays that the plants need that they don't grow as well in those kind of conditions. And you might be able to mitigate that a little bit during the summertime by having a window open. But of course, for many parts of the country, that's not going to work during the wintertime. Now, east windows can also be a consideration in your house too, but you have to take a couple things in consideration for east windows, and that is how much sun that you get in the morning. For a lot of us on the west coast, all the way up and down in Oregon, Washington, California, British Columbia, we have morning fog or morning clouds, and so our east windows often don't work very well. However, if you're someplace like in the southwest or other parts of the country where it's a lot brighter first thing in the morning, hey, an east window might be just the right ticket for getting that 3 to 4 hours of direct sun. I want to go ahead and show you some Nepenthes here in my house and where I have in some of my windows and some of the situations that we have and just some kind of things to know about and to kind of keep in mind as you place yours in your home also. Right hanging over my shoulder here is a nice big plant I've had for many years. This is a Nepenthes truncata cross thorellii. It's a hybrid actually. It lives right here next to the TV set. We have a collection of Nepenthes over here that you see also, some different smaller plants and just even a few orchids and regular house plants in this spot also. As I was telling you about windows, this is an example of a west window that gets about 4 hours of sun on a sunny day. Now, you want to make sure you have a water tray underneath your plants, because when you water, you're going to get that runoff like I showed you in the earlier part of the video. Our big one up here actually has kind of the pot itself has a tray in there, but there's a bigger tray to catch any that maybe comes out of that since the other tray is so small. So a lot of people like these decorative ceramic pots, and those work great for this purpose. If you have an exceptionally dry home, or maybe you live in the desert southwest or someplace where a little extra humidity is going to be a good idea, a pebble tray like this is a really good thing, because that'll help create some ambient humidity around your plants also and give them that little boost that they like. Now, something that does happen seasonally, and don't let this take you off guard when this happens, but as the days begin getting short during the wintertime, it is very normal for Nepenthes to begin losing some of their pitchers. They'll kind of slowly brown from the top, and they'll stay that way for a while, and finally, when you don't really like the way they look anymore, you can just go ahead and cut them off at the end of the leaf, like we kind of showed in the little demo before. And that's perfectly normal for that cycle to happen. In the spring, when the days lengthen, you'll see new pitchers developing again. And if you live in a tropical area, there's a good chance you'll see the pitchers all throughout the season, because that's closer to what they would experience in their native ranges in Southeast Asia.
In the home, most Nepenthes will grow well in a sunny south or west window. Ideally, plants should get 3 to 4 hours of direct sunlight with bright indirect light or filtered light throughout the rest of the day. If you live in a region where morning fog is common, avoid east windows. Otherwise, an east window is an excellent choice for direct morning sunlight. Avoid north windows. North windows lack sufficient sunlight for optimal growth, color, and pitcher production. After placing your plant in the appropriate window, make sure to keep the soil moist at all times. Use a saucer to catch excess water. While it's okay if small amounts of water are in the saucer after watering your plants, always avoid large amounts of standing water. In northern climates, it's perfectly normal for pitcher production to slow down when the days get shorter in winter. You might even see pitchers dry up. Simply cut off the dried pitchers when you can't stand looking at them anymore. Look for new pitchers when the days get longer in spring. If you live in a tropical climate, you will most likely get to enjoy pitchers throughout the year. With the right care, your Nepenthes can live for many, many years.
Hopefully you got a chance to see through the period of our video here, the Nepenthes are definitely not these exotic, you know, delicate waifs that cannot be grown anything except a really hot, humid greenhouse or some kind of a terrarium. These are plants that can be very much be lined up right beside a philodendron or some other house plant and can be just a fantastic conversation piece in your house.
To learn more about growing Nepenthes or other carnivorous plants, read our ebook on CD-ROM, Secrets to Growing Beautiful Carnivorous Plants for Your Home and Garden. There's also books like Carnivorous Plants by Adrian Slack, and two books by Charles Clark, Nepenthes of Borneo and Nepenthes of Sumatra.
And thanks for watching, and good growing.